Okay, so what we will do now is to look at singular perturbation methods in fluid mechanics, and we will also one second, I'll just check if I can get this. Okay. I will deal with a simple problem of fluid mechanics, but I mean it's actually not a simple problem. It's an elegant, very elegant problem in fluid mechanics, and we will see how to understand this problem from perturbation techniques. Okay, and but I'm guessing not everybody is familiar with regular and singular perturbation methods. So it's something that people it's worth learning about it because it gives you an insight which conventional methods don't. I mean you can actually do interesting problems which are not possible with conventional measurement techniques. Okay, so we'll start with a very classical problem in fluid mechanics. So let me start with that. I'll write the topic here. So we're looking at. Oh, I don't know why my. Perturbation methods. Okay, so perturbation methods, you have a variety of different perturbation methods. Okay. So let's start with the simple ones. Okay, they are called, let's they, you can call them as local analysis. Okay, you can divide them into local and global analysis. Okay, and an excellent book for perturbation methods, if somebody wants to learn perturbation methods, is a book by Bender, Carl Bender, and Steve Orszag. I don't know why my iPad is misbehaving. Steve Orszag, it's called Perturbation Methods. Okay. I mean, exact title, I'm not 100% sure. I think it's something on the lines of Perturbation Methods. There's also a very nice book by the same title, Perturbation Methods, by Professor E.J. Hinch, John Hinch. And his book is another classic in the subject. And of course, there are books by Neife and Van Dyck. Etc. Okay, Milton Van Dyck's book, unfortunately, is not available anymore. At least to the best of my knowledge, it's not or is out of print now. But Hinch's book is available, and it's worth looking at it. I personally like the style of Bender and Orszag. It's an absolutely great book. Okay, so you can broadly divide perturbation methods into two categories. Okay, the first one is you can call it as a regular perturbation methods. Sorry, local perturbation analysis. In local perturbation analysis, what you can do is you can do analysis near ordinary points. Okay. This is what we call as Taylor series analysis. Okay, I'll move these names to the side. Okay. Taylor series analysis. Then you have perturbation near regular singular points. We call it the Frobenius analysis. And then you have perturbation methods that you do analysis near irregular singular points. You can call this as the method of dominant balance. Okay. And then you have these methods called the global analysis. Now, the global analysis, there are three prominent methods that are commonly used for global analysis. The first one is boundary layer analysis. Or I'll just call it as boundary layer theory. The second one is WKBJ. Analysis. And the third one, which Ashok was telling me today before lunch, that this was touched upon in the earlier lectures, that is method of multiple scales. Okay. Now, all these methods are used in various ways. As you can see, the local analysis is something that all of you learn without calling it the local analysis. The most common one is the Taylor series analysis. The Taylor series analysis, you must have all of you would know that the Taylor series expansion, as we call it, is valid. Or you can basically, if you know the value of the function at a point, then you can get the value of the function at neighboring points, provided the function is smooth or analytic, as it's called. Okay, if the function is well defined and smooth in the neighborhood, then in principle you can get the function value at neighboring points. So if you know the function at, let's say, at this point x naught, you can get the function at any other point, which is x naught plus delta x. Okay, and this, by the way, can be a vector. So x naught is a vector, position vector, delta x is a vector from there. Okay, you can get, if you know the function here, f of x naught, then you can get the function at x naught plus delta x simply by basically writing an infinite series expansion. Okay, because the function is smooth, it's assumed that you can calculate higher order derivatives of this function. That is, if you write down the Taylor series expansion of f of x naught plus delta x, it will be in terms of f of x naught plus delta x times f prime of x naught plus delta x square by 2 factorial f double prime of x naught, and so on. It's an infinite series. Okay. Now, there are other methods, even the Frobenius method and the method of dominant balances are local analysis. Now, I want to particularly focus on a different method called the boundary layer analysis. Okay, this is not something that is commonly done in other fields. And this method was specifically, in some sense, developed for fluid mechanics. But now we find that it has uses in many other fields. Okay. A lot of development happened in the context of boundary layers in the 40s and the 50s. Okay, and these methods basically were sort of more or less rigorously written down in the early 50s. Okay, and let's look at boundary layer analysis and why boundary layer analysis is so important. Why is it important to study? Okay, now one of the most classical problems in fluid mechanics, and I said this is boundary analysis in the context of fluid mechanics. Okay, well, sorry, perturbation method in the context of fluid mechanics. So I'll give you one example. So this is boundary layer for a flat plate. Okay. Now, if you take a flat plate like this, the standard conditions that you would apply on the surface of the plate would be u equal to 0, v equal to 0. That's the no slip conditions. I'm just writing it in 2D, but the same applies for 3D as well. Okay. Let's put it this way. Instead of writing it in terms of components, let me write it in terms of a vector. U equal to 0. At y equal to 0. This is y equal to 0. Okay. Now I will have a, I'll take a coordinate system which is like this. This is y for me. X and z are in the horizontal plane of the plate. Okay. Now we know that when a uniform flow hits this plate, then a boundary layer is formed. Okay. Whose thickness grows with x. Let's say the thickness of the boundary layer, we'll call it as delta of x. Okay. Now we know from fluid mechanics that the boundary layer profile would be something like this. Why is it like this? Because we know that in the far field, as y goes to infinity, u bar goes to capital U. Meaning it's a uniform flow in the x direction. E of x is basically the unit vector in x direction. Okay. So what you really have is you have this uniform flow capital U. Far away from the plate, the velocity will be capital U, right? But very close to the plate, the velocity has to go to zero. Now the question is to really appreciate what this famous gentleman Ludwig Prandtl did. If I remember the year correctly, I think it was 1904. Okay. He basically formally wrote up, presented this boundary layer theory. In fact, it was actually in a conference. It was in the International Union of Mathematicians. Okay. He presented this work, and what Prandtl's work, to really appreciate what Prandtl did, one needs to really understand what is the thickness of the boundary layer. What are we really talking about? What in terms of thickness of the boundary layer? Okay. Now we know from, if you do boundary layer analysis, and I'm not going to do it here. That's not the purpose of this lecture. We know that delta of x goes like xy square root of Reynolds number as a function of x. So if I call this as x equal to zero, and I want to find out at some location x, what is the Reynolds number? And Reynolds number at this location, this is some finite value at this x, okay? And the Reynolds number at that place would be Reynolds number as a function of x will be u into x by kinematic viscosity nu. Okay, so let's understand, let's take a standard problem and see how small that is. This is an aircraft wing. Okay, commercial aircraft wing, let's say. Okay, and you have a flow that's coming here. And you have, when the fluid comes here, it'll basically go around it. You have this nice smooth flow over this wing. Okay, let's take some rough numbers. Okay, I don't know if you have traveled in a commercial airline, you'll see that the typical span of the wing will be well over a meter. Okay, the width of the thing. So let's say I'm starting here, and there is a smooth boundary layer which has formed over here. I want to find out what is the thickness of the boundary layer, what is delta at x is 1 meter. And this is a plane that is traveling at very high speeds. Okay. So what's a typical, can anybody tell me what's a typical speed of an aeroplane? Anybody? Okay, right. Let's take it's significantly higher than what we can travel in a car. So I'll take up some rough numbers. Okay, let's say it's 500 kilometers per hour, or maybe 600 kilometers per hour. Okay, so that comes out to be roughly, I'm writing it in a meters per second. So let's say the speed is approximately 100 meters per second. That's actually already on the lower side, by the way. Okay. We have a wind tunnel in our in IIT Hyderabad, where we can generate up to 35 meters per second in that wind tunnel. Okay. It's a low speed, that's called a low speed wind tunnel. It can generate up to 35 meters per second. And I can put an object, I can study what is the what kind of pressure and drag forces and so on I can get for floor objects. Okay. Typically commercial airlines, when they fly at a speed of something like okay, actually the numbers are higher. Let's say we'll take the number to be 200. That commercial airlines, when they fly at cruising altitude, they fly at an speed of 0.85 Mach number. Okay. Now that is nothing but it is 85% of speed of sound. Okay. Now speed of sound, I know at the ground level is 330 meters per second. So 85% of that is obviously going to be much higher than 200. But we will assume that the speed of sound at higher altitude is actually less. So we'll take it to be 200 meters per second, or maybe we'll just stick to our earlier number. We'll just take some 100 meters per second. Let's see. Okay, what do we get? Now we have, and kinematic viscosity of air is around 1.8 into 10 power minus 6 meter square per second. This is the speed, kinematic viscosity. Okay. Let me just be sure that that number is correct. I always remember forgetting this exact number. Okay. So it's actually, I was wrong. It's not minus 6, it's actually minus 5. Okay. And it may not be 1.8, it may be 1.5, it doesn't matter for the purposes of this lecture. Okay. So now we have everything. We have u, we have nu, we have x. Therefore, Reynolds number at that x of 1 meter, what is the value? U into x by nu. That is 100 into 1 by 1.8 into 10 power minus 5. Okay, 1.8 I'll approximately to be 2. So 100 by 2 is 5. 5 into 10 power 5. Okay, 5 into 10 power 5 is the Reynolds number. Therefore, delta of x that we get is x by square root of Reynolds number. Okay, that is 1 by square root of 5 into 10 power 5. Okay, let me pull out my calculator. And this comes out to be around approximately 1 by 700. Okay, and 1 by 700 is 1 by 700 is 0.0015. Okay, are you able to follow me? Huh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so 0.0015 is what you get. So what does it mean? So it means the delta of, and remember this is in meters. So delta of x is, what is 0.0015 meters? That is 1.5 millimeters. 1.5 millimeters. Okay, let's say I made some approximations. It's not, the number is not perfectly correct and all that, and some people want to dispute it. It's still on the order of 2-3 millimeters, a few millimeters. Okay, now think about how amazing that is. So you have a wing over an aircraft like this. Okay. You have a wing over an aircraft like this. And what you really have is you have a boundary layer, you have a region very close to the boundary layer, and there's no way I can make it thinner than this. Okay, you have a region where the velocity is actually going to zero. So if I were to zoom into this entire region is only a few millimeters. It's in the order of millimeters in that region, whereas the entire thing is of the order of a meter. So it is so thin, the boundary layer is so thin that you won't be able to see it. It's that thin. If I were to zoom into that region, this is what you will see. This is like boundary layer. If you zoom into that region, you will see that the velocity goes to zero in that small region. That's how small the boundary layer is. Okay. Now, what one can do is to say, well, it is such a small region, so let's ignore it. Correct? It's such a small, thin region. Why bother about it? Let's ignore it. Okay. Which is what a lot of people in fluid mechanics did before Prandtl. Okay. So before Prandtl, you can broadly say fluid dynamics was divided before this gentleman. You can broadly say fluid dynamics was divided into two parts. A viscous fluid mechanics, okay, where people primarily looked at viscous dominated flows, where there was no Reynolds number, there was no inertia at all. Okay. People did a lot of impressive theoretical development in that. And people also looked at inviscid fluid mechanics, where there was no viscosity. So in one hand, there was no inertia, and the other hand, there was no viscosity. Prandtl came along and said, look, you need there, no matter how small this region is, there are certain regions where you cannot ignore the presence of the boundary layer. Okay. Now, and it'll become clear. So I'll give you two reasons why, both from a mathematical perspective and a physical perspective, why his intuition was so amazing. Okay. So let's look at the mathematical perspective. Let's write down the Navier-Stokes equations. Okay. The Navier-Stokes equations will be, in if I write it in vector form, it is density times del u bar by del t plus u dot grad u is minus grad p plus mu del square u. Okay. If you non-dimensionalize it, then you would get del u bar by del t plus u dot grad u. Let's call the dimensional terms with a tilde, just to make sure that these are dimensional terms. Is minus grad p plus 1 by Reynolds times del square u. This is the non-dimensional form of the Navier-Stokes equations. Okay. Now, notice that this term is a second order derivative. So this equation, the number of boundary conditions to solve this equation is dictated by this last viscous term. Okay. Now, if Re is equal to infinity, if you set it exactly equal to infinity, then what you get is you get this equation. You get this is the Euler's equation. And this is Navier-Stokes equations or Navier-Stokes equations. You see the fundamental difference between the Euler's and the Navier-Stokes equations. The Navier-Stokes equations have a 1 by Reynolds term there, okay, which means that it's a second order nonlinear differential equation. But the Euler's equation, the second order term is gone. The highest derivative term is gone. And once the highest derivative term is gone, you do not need enough number of those many boundary conditions to solve this equation. Okay. Now so if you were to solve flow over an aerofoil like this, you have to either put the boundary condition at infinity or on the surface of the body. Correct? You cannot put both. So if you were to solve the same problem through Euler's equation, then the boundary, then In this equation, what you actually have is the flow would look like this. There'll be a uniform flow because you have to, it makes more sense to say that the velocity in the far field is constant or whatever is prescribed. Okay, but near the body, there is no reason for the velocity to go to zero. There is no reason for a no slip condition. And therefore, the boundary condition that you would impose on the body, there would be no boundary condition you would impose on the body. Okay, in the Euler's equations. The only condition that you will impose is no penetration condition. Okay. You will impose that on the surface of the body, velocity is, vertical velocity is zero. Normal component of the velocity is zero. Okay. Now, what is the problem with this? One is you have lost out one boundary condition. The Euler's equation, by throwing out this highest derivative, you cannot impose that condition, the no slip condition. But we know from experiments that the no slip boundary condition is valid. Okay. So if the no slip boundary condition is indeed valid in the experiments, how do we work with high Reynolds number flow? Okay. What Prandtl says is no matter how large the Reynolds number is, no matter how large it is, okay, this term can never be zero. The last term. Okay. I will basically highlight this term. This term can never be zero. Prandtl says the reason that term cannot be zero is because even though 1 by Reynolds number is becoming very, very, very small, the derivative of velocity is becoming very, very large. Okay. It's becoming so large that to compensate to the higher the Reynolds number, the larger is the derivative, such that the product of a very small number and a very large number is finite. Is that clear? So if I think about a boundary layer, I can draw boundary layers in two different scenarios. One is a thick boundary layer, and in another case, it's a very thin boundary layer, but it's the same magnitude of the velocity. So in the thin boundary layer, the slope is much steeper. Okay, and then the slope is given by del u by del y. Is higher, much higher here, or rather, if I were to compare, these two, del u by del y in this case, the magnitude is smaller than del u by del y in this case. Okay, in these two different boundary layers, the velocity gradients are much smaller. Therefore, the second derivatives are even smaller. Okay. This is something that Prandtl had a brilliant intuition. He recognized that it's wrong, no matter how large a Reynolds number, it is wrong to throw out that term. That is mathematically, that's one thing. Okay, you're not satisfied the boundary condition. The second one is when you have a flow over an object, there is a drag force because of the presence of viscosity. Correct? This drag force because of viscosity, this is called the viscous drag. Okay. This viscous drag can never be captured if you throw out viscosity term from the problem. Because ultimately, Reynolds number term is your viscous term. I don't know why this color changed. The Reynolds number term is your viscous term. So if you throw out the term, you basically thrown out viscosity from the problem. It's an inviscid fluid. And an inviscid fluid cannot give you any skin friction drag. Okay, it cannot give you the drag because of motion, literally the motion of the fluid scraping on the surface. Okay. So, I mean, drag is broadly two categories. You can have a form drag and a skin friction drag, or a pressure drag and a skin friction drag. This form drag is something that you may still be able to get. Okay, even that you'll make a mistake. But the skin friction drag you definitely cannot get. But in the case of Prandtl argued that if you ignore the term, you'll be completely wrong in the amount of drag force that you get. Okay, so now what is the lesson from this? The lesson from this is there are always certain regions in a problem where the solution can vary very rapidly. It can vary so rapidly that you may not be able to anticipate. If you just ignore that term, you may make a huge mistake. Okay, and of course you cannot satisfy the boundary condition. Okay. Now, I will illustrate this with a very, this is one example. There are many other examples where you would encounter, okay? But this is probably the most famous example where for singular perturbation theory. Let's look at a simple equation. I will illustrate this with simple differential equations that all of you are familiar with, okay? And we will analyze this, analyze the solution more carefully, okay? Now, unfortunately, I don't think I can actually show the exact solution as a curve, but I will let's work out the solutions first, okay? Let's take an example. Let's take a first order differential equation. Maybe I'll open MATLAB and I'll plot the solution there, okay? So let's first look at the solution. The simple equation that I'm going to take is epsilon y prime plus y equals sine x. It's a simple first order differential equation, linear first order differential equation, okay? And it has a simple initial condition, y of 0 is equal to 1 for x greater than or equal to 0, okay? This is the problem that I've given. Okay. Now, do you know how to get the exact solution for this? Does anybody know how do you do it? Anybody who can tell me how you'd solve this? Everybody is tired, huh? Is everybody around? Are you guys around?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. How would I solve this equation? Complementary function, particular integral. Okay. It's a simple first order differential equation, no? What is RK method? Martin, what is RK method? Well, it'll be good if you tell me, Runge-Kutta method. No, that's numerically, right? Numerically, you can solve it in various ways. I'm interested in asking, how do you solve this by hand? So integrating factors, right? I can solve it through integrating factors. One way to write this is you take epsilon on the other side, divide throughout by epsilon, you write it as y prime by y. Okay. I mean, you can just multiply it by the integrating factor throughout. Then the left hand side basically gets combined into one single term, and you can take the derivative of it and solve it. Okay. This is a standard, this is of the form. It doesn't matter, okay? You can solve it through this method, or and I'll write down the exact solution. Exact solution means no approximations. The exact solutions of this problem is sine x plus epsilon cos x divided by 1 plus epsilon square plus epsilon by 1 plus epsilon square e power minus x by epsilon. This is my exact solution. Okay, right? Now, can we verify that the exact solution satisfies the boundary condition? We'll do a check. At x is equal to 0, what do I have? Y exact is sine 0. Sine 0 is 0. Minus epsilon cos 0 is 1. Minus epsilon by 1 plus epsilon square. Plus epsilon by 1 plus epsilon. Did I make some mistake? x equal to 0, right? Sin x. Just give me 1 second. I think I messed up somewhere, is it? 0 is 1. This is going to 0. That's not very helpful. Let me just make sure that I've got the exact solution correct. I'm just working it out. Can you try to solve this, all of you, this equation? This one. Give me a minute, I'm just making sure that I've not got something wrong. First function, then second function, integral derivative of function. Okay, that sounds okay. Just getting cross sets. Okay, I think I'm getting this. Where did my pen go? Okay, so I'm just getting a plus here. Is that okay? Did any of you try this out? I'm getting a plus here. So this seems to be. Oh, no, there's another. Why exact? Let me just do this here. Simple. Why D. Let's just do this. Epsilon dy by dx plus y equal to sine x. So I have integrating factor would be, dy by dx plus 1 by epsilon y is 1 by epsilon sine x. And then I have exponential of integral 1 by epsilon dx. That is e power x by epsilon. So just to check that the integrating factor is okay, I'll multiply by dy by dx plus 1 by epsilon x by epsilon y is 1 by epsilon x by epsilon sine x. Okay. So this becomes e power x by epsilon times y. That looks okay. 1 by epsilon. Okay. This is 1 by epsilon e power x by epsilon sine x, and now I can integrate it. I have x by epsilon times y. This becomes integral of x by epsilon sine x dx. Okay, and I have exponential of x by epsilon integral of sine, I think, is minus cosine x minus integral of derivative of this, that will be 1 by epsilon x by epsilon times Other, just I forgot how. It's been such a long time I've done these problems. Let's define I. Dx. That is. Integral of 1 by epsilon x by epsilon minus cos x dx. That is x by epsilon cos x plus 1 by epsilon integral of x by epsilon cos x dx. Okay. And minus x by epsilon cos x. Cos x, I think, is sin x. Sin x dx. So I have I into 1 plus 1 by epsilon square is equal to minus x by epsilon cos x plus 1 by epsilon sin x. Okay. So that is x by epsilon times epsilon, if I take common, then I have minus cos x minus sin x by epsilon. Okay. This is I, and therefore if I put everything together, where did I define I? Oh. What am I doing here? What is I? It's e power x by s thing sin. Okay, this is I. Okay, so I have e power x by epsilon y, that's here, is equal to 1 by epsilon times this integral, and that will be minus, I've forgotten something which is important, which is okay, I can add an integration constant there. I'm adding integration constant C there. It is 1 by epsilon plus C. Okay. at x equal to 0, I have minus epsilon. Okay, oh boy, it's taken me lot much longer than I did. So this is the exact solution as I can see it. Okay. All right. So it looks quite tedious, but it can be worked out. And now let's look at this is again to just reiterate what is this exact solution of. This is the exact solution of this equation: epsilon y prime plus y is equal to sine x with y of 0 is equal to 1. Okay, right? Now you can verify that. Let's check whether the boundary condition is satisfied, initial condition is satisfied. If I substitute x equal to 0, I have minus epsilon by 1 plus epsilon square. Okay, and here I have plus epsilon by 1 plus epsilon square, that cancels out. I have 1 plus epsilon square by 1 plus epsilon square, that's 1. Okay, e power 0 is 1. Okay, so it seems to satisfy the boundary the initial condition. Okay, initial condition or boundary condition does not matter. It's a first order differential equation. Okay. Now, the solution of this equation, we can plot it and check, but I will not do it right now. Okay, it looks complicated, right? It looks tedious, complicated. But let's consider a situation where if epsilon is very, very small, what happens? Okay, I can make epsilon as small as I want if I want to, correct? If I make epsilon to be really small, then I could do one simplification, which is to say, if epsilon is very small, we will set epsilon is equal to 0. How does it matter? I mean, anyway, epsilon is very, very small. Okay. If epsilon is very small, I'll set epsilon is equal to 0. Then the equation becomes y equal to sine x. Correct? Huh? Immediately it becomes y equal to sine x. And the moment y equal to sine x, this solution does not satisfy the condition y of 0 equal to 1. In fact, if I were to draw these two solutions, the simplified solution and shown in red is like this. This is sine x, but the solution that you're going to get here, the other one, okay, if epsilon is very, very small, let's simplify the other solution, the exact solution. This is y approximate. This is y approximate. Oh. Okay. What about the other solution? Y of x, the exact solution. Okay. I know that it starts at y of 0 is equal to 1. So it means that it is starting here. That solution is starting there. Okay. Second thing is, when epsilon is very, very small, what about this last term? Epsilon exponential of minus x by epsilon. If epsilon is very, very small, exponential of minus x by epsilon is really, really goes to 0, practically goes to 0 as x becomes large, correct? Because that becomes goes to negative infinity. Okay, when x becomes large, it becomes large, but then now you have 1 by epsilon there, which is also a very large number. So this number becomes exponential of a very small number. Exponential of a very small number is very close to 0, which means that the entire second term of this, the one that I'm showing in this blue, this entire second term will become negligible as x becomes large. What about the first term? when epsilon is very, very small, what you have is y exact. For epsilon much smaller than 1 is approximately sine x, okay. Second term is anyway epsilon is very, very small. Compared to sine x, cos epsilon cos x is very small. And therefore I have something times exponential of minus x by epsilon, which also disappears, which means that as x becomes large and epsilon has become small, this exact solution will approximately become sine x. Correct? So this solution, the way it actually looks like is, it may look, I don't exactly know how it look, it's going to look like, but it's going to follow this curve eventually. You understand? So I have a solution which is following this curve, but only near x equal to 0, only near x equal to 0, it is going to deviate from the simplified solution of sine x. Is everybody following this? I mean, there's all round silence.
Yes, sir.
See, I hope you can please try to write it down yourself. Otherwise, you'll not be able to appreciate what's going on. Okay.
Yeah.
All I have done is I have said, I've got a y exact solution, and exact solution, what happens? I'm asking what happens when x is large and epsilon is small. Okay, that's all I'm doing, nothing more in the exact solution. When x is very large, obviously that exponential of negative x term will become small anyway. But now you, to make matters worse, you have 1 by epsilon there. 1 by epsilon will become very large but negative. So exponential of this entire second term in the exact solution goes to 0. And anyway, in the sine x and cos x, sine x is between minus 1 and 1, cos x also between minus 1 and 1. But before the cos x, there's a poor epsilon sitting there. So that poor thing, second term also goes to 0 in the numerator, in sine x minus epsilon cos x. So it practically becomes sine x by 1 plus epsilon square. But again, 1 plus epsilon square is approximately 1. So you recover sine x, you see? So what ended up happening is you recover the sine x solution that you are getting anyway by setting epsilon is equal to 0. But epsilon equal to 0 clearly is not valid everywhere. Correct? It is not valid definitely near x is equal to 0. Because near x is equal to 0, the solution that you get does not satisfy the condition y of 0 equal to 1. Okay. Now this is a very good example of a singular perturbation problem. Okay. There has to be something funny going on near x equal to 0. Okay. So the question that I have is, in this particular problem, I can get an exact solution. But there are many problems where the exact solution is very difficult to get and we may not even be able to get it. Okay. So in such cases, can we basically look for an approximate solution? So in many engineering problems, you want to get an approximate solution which is valid, rather than be absolutely precise. In fact, so in many problems, the only alternative to getting the full solution is to go for a numerical solution. But a numerical solution is valid only for those specific parameters. Like, you can't solve this numerically unless you specify the value of epsilon. Correct? Any numerical solution, any method you take, you have to specify the value of epsilon. You choose epsilon 0.1, 0.01, whatever. But you have to solve only for that value of epsilon. I don't want that. I want an approximate solution which will still give me necessary insight into what is going on. So therefore, we will basically look for a perturbation solution. Okay. This is your first introduction to perturbation, applying singular perturbation methods. Okay. We will look for an approximate solution. Approximate solution using singular perturbations. Singular perturbation theory. Okay. Let us see what is this approximate solution in the singular perturbation theory. Now, I do know that something funny is going on. In this region. Okay, very close to that region. Okay, correct? Because that's where the solution is deviating. So let us assume that there is a region of some size delta near that region. Okay, meaning, let me first illustrate this graphically. This is X and this is Y. So what we will do is we'll assume that there is a thin region I will assume that in this small region near X is equal to zero. Okay, I have amplified this, deliberately made this look large. I will say that there is a region of size delta. Okay. And in that region, I will rescale the value of X, because remember, X is becoming very small. This is X equal to zero. Okay, I have amplified that region. So in that region, I will say that X is equal to delta, capital delta of X. I will also say that Y of X is a new variable, capital Y of X. I've introduced two new variables, capital X and capital Y. What is the idea? What is the logic behind it? The idea is that as X goes to zero, okay, X goes to zero, capital X, which is X by delta, okay, capital X delta is still large. It's still not very small. In the sense that I've taken this little region and I've stretched it out. Okay. Got it. I've taken a very small region near X is equal to zero and I've stretched it out in the X. Okay. So now I can write down, it will become clear the moment you look at the derivatives, d small y by dx, I can write it in terms of capital Y. Okay. What is the derivative of d capital Y? Small y is capital Y, d capital Y by dx. But what is small x? I can write it in terms of capital X. I can write it as z capital Y by dx, d capital X by d small x. Okay. And this nothing but d capital X by d capital X times, what is d capital X by d small x? It is 1 by delta, correct? So you see the idea of what now. Okay, this is what I have now. Now let's basically substitute this derivative. Let's examine this. What it means is that when delta is very, very small, if delta is small, and I don't know how small it is, I don't know the value of delta, but I've just taken delta to be small. Okay. Okay, I've just taken some arbitrary delta is small. We will determine the size of delta. If delta is small, then I know that dy by dx goes like 1 by delta, which means that it is very, very large. Okay, remember the solution y. The solution y is between minus 1 and plus 1. There's nothing funny about y. But there's something funny going on with dy by dx. Okay, so what I've done is I have rescaled X, capital X, small x and small y, such that this quantity here, this quantity capital dy by dx is still an order one number, but the other one becomes very small. 1 by delta is very small, which means that the slope is becoming very large. Okay, and that's why there is a mismatch in the solution. Okay. Let's substitute this into the equation. What do I have now? Dy by dx I have. If I have dy by dx, I have epsilon. That's my equation is what? epsilon y prime. Epsilon times y prime is nothing but 1 by delta d capital y by d capital x plus, what's the next one? Plus small y, but small y is same as capital Y, is equal to sine of x. But what is x? Delta times capital X. Okay. With capital Y of capital X is equal to 0 is 1. Because small y is 1, right? If y of 0 equal to 1, it means that capital Y of 0 is also 1. Because small x and capital X both go to 0 at x is equal to 0. Correct? So far, were you guys with me? All I've done is I've tried to stretch that region. Okay. Now let's write this down again. So what I have is epsilon by delta d capital Y by dx plus y is sine delta x. This is what I have. Okay. Now, what was happening earlier when I said epsilon is equal to 0? Look at the text that I wrote in red. When epsilon goes to 0, what was really happening? The derivative term was disappearing. Okay. When epsilon goes to 0, the derivative term is disappearing. We basically set the derivative to 0. That's a mistake. The reason it's a mistake is because we have assumed that when epsilon is becoming vanishingly small, when epsilon is really small, we set epsilon is equal to 0. Well, okay. So that's obviously a problem. I have said if epsilon is very, very small, it is entirely possible that the derivative becomes very large. So that the product of a very small epsilon and a very large slope will compensate each other. You understand? Huh? That possibility I have not given myself. I have ignored that possibility. Okay. Which was the mistake that I was making earlier. So now I don't want to make that mistake again. I want to retain the derivative term. If I want to retain this derivative term, let me write this down. To retain the first derivative term, we can choose delta is equal to epsilon. Okay. If I choose this, now I have a new differential equation. We now have a boundary layer of size epsilon near x is equal to 0. Near x equal to 0, I have a slightly different equation. What is the nature of this equation? The equation is, because epsilon, delta and epsilon are the same, that becomes the coefficient becomes 1 in this equation. I have d capital Y by d capital X plus y is sine of, instead of delta X, I have epsilon X. Okay, huh? Now, how do I solve this equation? There are so many ways to solve this. Again, you can solve it exactly if you want, but there are, since we are anyway trying to get an approximate solution, what we will do is we'll solve through something called a regular perturbation expansion. We'll solve through a regular perturbation expansion. Okay. What do we write is we say capital Y of X, but it also depends on epsilon. This will be Y0 plus epsilon Y1 plus epsilon square Y2 plus so on. Okay. Y0 is nothing but epsilon power 0. It's a power series that I've assumed in epsilon. Okay. I have also said that sine of epsilon capital X, I know is epsilon X minus sine X is X minus X cubed by 3 factorial. that is 3 cube by 3 factorial plus 1. Okay. Now I can substitute this directly there, correct? So I have d by d capital X of y0, y1, y2 plus y0 is equal to this is what I have. Okay. Just give me 1 second. Okay. So now let's basically, now if I look at this equation, it's a, I have a very complicated looking equation, but let's basically take term by term. Okay. What a term by term is, epsilon is arbitrary. Remember, epsilon, I have not told you what is the value of epsilon. Epsilon, all I said is epsilon is a small number. Okay, it's very small compared to one. But I want a solution for arbitrary epsilon. Okay. All I know is it's small. If I know epsilon is small, then what I can do is I can, because epsilon is arbitrary, this equation has to be satisfied, has to be valid for every order of epsilon independent of each other. Which means that I can take the order one solution, order one equations. Order one equations is what? It is d by d capital X of y0. Only order one is epsilon power zero. That's what I mean. This is order epsilon power zero. Okay. Plus y0. This is equal to zero. With y of zero is one. Okay. I forgot to mention one thing, but maybe I should mention that before I solve this. This is the governing equation, right? What about the boundary condition? What about the boundary condition? Boundary condition says y of 0 is equal to 1, which means that it is y0 of 0 plus epsilon y1 of 0 epsilon square y2 of 0 plus so on is equal to 1. Okay, 1 also can, right hand side, 1 can also be written as 1 into epsilon power 0 plus 0 into epsilon power 1, 0 into epsilon power 2, and so on, right hand side. Because I have no terms on the right hand side, I have only 1. Okay, this is anyway 1. Okay, so now you can clearly see I can write down the equation for order epsilon power 0. I can also write down the boundary condition for order epsilon power 0, which means that I will only match the left hand side and the right hand side. I will look for terms which do not have epsilon. Okay. If I do this, then I immediately have y of 0 equal to 0, y of 0 equal to 1. Okay. And I can solve this now. I will immediately get e power minus capital X. That's the first solution. Okay. Now let's look at an order epsilon solution or order epsilon equation. So because already the zeroth order is taken away, now we look at the order epsilon. What are the terms I have? I have this term here. And on the right hand side, I have this. And then the boundary conditions, I have this is equal to this. Okay. So let's write down the equations. What do I have? I have dy1 by d capital X. Remember, every term will have X before it, epsilon before it. So I don't have to write epsilon again. Okay. This plus y1 is equal to capital X. Okay. With y1 of 0 equal to 0. Now you see, this is a completely new differential equation. Okay, this is a completely new differential equation with a different boundary condition. I can solve for it. Okay, again, method of integrating factors is capital X minus 1 plus e power minus X. That's the solution that I've written down in my notes here. Okay, Now I can put everything together. Now I have y1 as well. Okay. Let's ignore. I don't want any. If epsilon is very small, epsilon square will be even smaller. So I don't want to bother about writing higher order terms. Now we'll just say putting all of it together. We have y of x, which will be y0. y0 is e power minus x plus epsilon y1. Epsilon times y1, that is x minus 1 plus e power minus x plus an error which is of order delta epsilon square. Okay. Now we can convert this back into our original condition equation. Therefore, small y of x is nothing but e power. What is capital X? Capital X is small x by delta, but delta is epsilon, so it is x by delta plus epsilon times, what do I have now? x by epsilon minus 1 plus e power minus x by epsilon plus order epsilon square. Okay. And this I can simplify it. This is x minus epsilon plus epsilon e power minus x by epsilon plus order epsilon square. Okay. Now this solution you can clearly check. This solution satisfies the boundary condition. Does it satisfy the boundary condition? Y of 0 is 1. If you check, this becomes 1. Then I have minus epsilon plus epsilon, that goes to 0. So this satisfies the boundary condition. Y of 0 is equal to 1. Okay. Is this clear? Okay.
Yes,
so, okay. Now what we will do is this solution, when epsilon itself becomes very, very small, the epsilon minus epsilon minus e power minus x by epsilon term that is there, it decays rapidly. Okay. It decays so rapidly that the solution can have a large variation at x equal to 0, which I had not accounted for. Okay. If I take the derivative of this solution, you can clearly see that the derivative will have a 1 by epsilon before it. Because derivative of x by epsilon will be 1 by epsilon e power minus x by epsilon. You have a 1 by epsilon sitting in front. The moment I take the derivative, then it immediately says that there is a 1 by epsilon, which I had ignored. So really what is really happening is, in this original solution, I had epsilon very small. I accidentally made the mistake of saying epsilon very small is equal to epsilon is equal to 0. This is a problem. This is an important lesson. Small epsilon does not mean epsilon is 0. You cannot set epsilon equal to 0 just because it is small. That is because you need to have knowledge on the derivative. If the derivative is going to become very large, then you may be making a big blunder. Okay. So this is a very, very important learning that you get from looking at this problem. Okay. So we look at another problem as well, another second order differential equation. But I want to connect it to what we had seen in the boundary layer theory. In the boundary layer theory of Prandtl, okay. The derivative term, the term that I've highlighted in red, 1 by Reynolds number times del square u, the Reynolds number can become very, very large. Okay, so this term is really, this term that you see, it's really, the dominant term will be del square u by del y square, because most of the derivative is in the, this is y. This is y, and this is u of y. Okay. This term is approximately epsilon times del square u by del y square. If we have assumed that epsilon is very small, but we should also know that I can set that term to zero only if the derivative term is not very large. But if the derivative term becomes very large, then it's possible that it will compensate for this epsilon. Okay. You understand? In fact, that's absolutely true, because as I already said, if you look at the expression for if you look at this expression for delta of x goes like x power half. Okay. So the Reynolds number, okay, it doesn't matter. Okay. If you didn't get that point, it's fine. The Reynolds number can become very large, but this derivative can, Reynolds number can become very large, or its inverse of it can become very small, but the derivative can become very large. I cannot tell you how important this understanding is, and how important this problem, what this problem teaches us. Okay. An exact solution may not teach us this. Okay. Now, we will look at another problem. Now, in many, we look at another problem and to identify where the boundary layer is. In general, identifying the location of the boundary layer itself is not easy. Okay. So we've looked at a first order equation, but since boundary layer analysis that we saw is the fluid mechanics, we encounter second order equations. Let's look at the second order differential equation. Okay. I'm just thinking. Okay, maybe I'll show it. I've already have the notes here. I'll show you the solution through this. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. So, what do you see? You see the boundary layer equations. Okay. I wanted to show you. This is how the solution looks like. The previous problem. Okay. So, the exact solution is shown in black. Okay. And notice how beautifully. Just give me 1 second. I'll just. Open this and. I don't have a. Okay, I can show it through the mouse. Okay, I hope you can see where my mouse is pointing. Okay. The black curve that you see here is the exact solution. You see that? Now, the approximate solution that we got by setting epsilon is equal to zero is this blue curve. Clearly, the blue curve and the black curve do not match near x equal to zero, right? So what is really happening? What is really happening is a very steep slope. So the solution follows the blue curve. Okay, now you see the black curve and the blue curve are close to each other, but then it suddenly takes a turn and has a very steep slope up all the way to meet x is equal to one. You understand? So the solution that we got, what is called as the inner solution, is this. Okay, now the exact solution is the black. So very close to the, now you can, in fact, you can actually not distinguish, you cannot even distinguish between the solution, inner solution, because it's valid near epsilon equal to, for it valid near x equal to zero. You can't even distinguish it in the green curve and the red curve and the black curve, the exact solution and the inner solution. Is this clear? Okay, let's look at another problem. This is a single, this is a second order thing. Okay. So I have a differential equation like this, epsilon y double prime plus y prime is this. Now I have two boundary conditions here because it's a second order equation, correct? Now for these two boundary conditions, that I have here, I want to get an approximate solution. Okay. Now, in principle, it is possible to solve this equation, but it is a bit harder. Okay. But we'll not bother plotting the exact solution right now. Let's look at the solution technique. Okay. If I just do a simple expansion like this, epsilon is very small. Therefore, I will do an expansion like this. Y equal to y0 plus epsilon y1 and so on. Then I can immediately write down at order one, I can substitute the solution into the original equation. And I have a simple solution of this form, y0 prime, this one, this here, is equal to epsilon e power minus x. That's what I have. And if I just integrate it, I get y0 as some constant minus e power minus x. This is what I call as an outer solution. It will become clear why we call it an outer solution. Now I'll tell you what is the challenge with this. Okay, and I don't know if you've already been, some of you have been guessing. How do I determine C naught? Any suggestions? How do I get C naught?
We are applying boundary conditions.
Okay, so it's a single constant, right? That you have to get C naught. Which boundary condition will I apply? Should I apply y of 0 equal to 1 or should I apply y of 1 equal to 1?
First one.
Sorry?
Y of 0 equal to 1.
Why is that?
Because that is the first C naught value.
No, I could. C naught has nothing to do with x equal to 0. I never said that this solution is valid near x equal to 0, no? C naught has nothing to do with that. The 0 that I have written here, C0, that is because this is epsilon power 0. That has nothing to do with x near x equal to 0. This I call it a C naught because it is epsilon power 0. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
It's not right now. If you just think about it, it is not very clear which one you need. Remember, you can get C naught either by getting this using this condition or this condition. You can find C naught either way. Okay. But you won't know which one is correct. Okay. So which one should I do know one thing. I do know one thing, that this problem has a boundary layer. How do I know it has a boundary layer? Because if I set epsilon is equal to zero, this term will disappear. If this term disappears, then I do not, second derivative goes away. If the second derivative goes away, then I have y prime is e power minus x. If y prime is e power minus x, clearly you cannot apply two boundary conditions for a first order. This is the equation that I get. I'm not able to select this part. Wait, let me just open this on another. Window, because right now I'm not able to use the I can't use the tools even otherwise. Adobe Acrobat also I cannot use it. Okay, let's get back to this. So I cannot right now. Sorry. So I can get C naught from either one, okay, but I cannot decide. So what we will do is we will assume that there is a boundary layer near x equal to 0. Okay, first. We then assume that there is a boundary layer near x equal to 1. Remember, I have two boundaries, x equal to 0, x equal to 1. And we, using this analysis, we will figure out which one is correct. If you make a wrong assumption, meaning if you assume that the boundary layer is at the one place, but actually turns out to be in the other place, we will get an inconsistency in the solution. And that's exactly what I want to demonstrate. Okay, let's start by saying there is a boundary layer. I have said this. Let there be a boundary layer. Let there be a boundary layer at x equal to 0. Okay. Now, if there is a boundary layer at x equal to 0, then what do I have? I have very close to x equal to 0. I am assuming that the solution is rapidly diverging. Correct? If I'm assuming that the solution is rapidly changing, then I'm automatically stating that in this region, small x is very small near, because it's near x equal to 0. I'm saying that small x is delta times capital X, such that delta is very small. Okay. Now I have chosen a region where small x is very small, delta is very small, but capital X is not very small. Capital X is x by delta. So this goes to, this becomes small, this becomes small, but capital X is x by delta, which is not small. Okay. Now let's see what happens. If I substitute small x is this, just like in the before, I calculate the derivative dy by dx using the chain rule. I can write the entire equation in terms of capital Y. If I do this in terms of capital Y, then I have this simplified equation. Again, I can use a regular perturbation expansion. I can expand epsilon is small, and clearly epsilon is not appearing in front of any of the derivatives, this derivative. So I can happily do an expansion like this. And the leading order equation is this. Okay. And I can easily calculate the solution. Y0 of x is c1 plus c2 e power minus x. And I can, because I've already said that this is the gray region is where the boundary layer is, I automatically can apply the boundary condition at small x is 0. Small x is equal to 0 is capital X is equal to 0. Both are the same. So therefore, I can apply this boundary condition and get the exact solution. Sorry, I can get the solution near x equal to 0, but I still have an unknown constant, which is c1. Okay. Also, you can clearly see that this solution decays very rapidly. So what happens when x becomes very large? When x becomes very large, this solution goes to 0. Okay. The solution just goes to 0. And therefore, this solution is acceptable to us because I am getting a solution which is only valid near the inner region. Okay. But let's examine the other case. Okay. It will become more clear when you examine. Now, in this, this is a region where I'm saying that the boundary layer is on the other side at cap small x is equal to 1. So it means that small x is 1 minus delta x because x, I am, x is in this region, only in this gray region. What is this gray region? Gray region is 1 minus delta of capital X. Okay. Because when small x is equal to 1, what do I have here? 1 minus 1 that goes to 0. Capital X goes to 0. When meaning as small x goes to 1, capital X goes to 0. Understand? So now I can do the same thing. I can take the derivative. I can write down y of x as capital Y of x. I can take the derivative dy by dx as d capital Y by d small x, which is d capital Y by d capital X into d capital X by d small x using the chain rule. I can substitute it and I've got an equation like this. And I can again, this is the final equation that I've got here. I can use again a regular perturbation expansion and get the solution. And you can see that the solution goes exponentially. Okay, as x goes to, so I'm, when small x, capital X is 0, I'm here at this wall. Okay, I am at the small x is equal to 1 wall on the other boundary. So when capital X increases, which way am I going? I'm moving in the left direction. Okay, I'm moving left side. Okay. Maybe I can show this using give me 1 second. I'm sharing the screen, so I'll do it on my iPad so that you can clearly see the sorry about that. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that As I go away from here, okay, as I go away from here, I want the solution to decay. I don't want the solution to grow unbounded. If it grows unbounded, there is a problem because there is no way. So the boundary condition essentially is what? The boundary condition says y of 0 is 1, y of 1 is also 1, which means that my solution starts here and ends here. It could have some complicated shape here. I don't know what. It can't just go unbounded in the middle. Okay. But if I look at the other case where. If I look at the other region where I assume that the boundary layer is on the right side, then clearly you can clearly see that as I go in this way, meaning as x increases, as x goes to infinity, small x goes to 0, because I'm starting at capital X is equal to 0. This is capital X equal to 0, by the way. Small x is equal to 1. Okay. And as I'm going in that direction, you can clearly see that the solution is becoming very large. And once the solution is becoming very large, I clearly cannot satisfy. I clearly cannot satisfy the boundary condition. So this solution is not acceptable to me. So I conclude that the solution, there has to be a boundary layer near small x is equal to 0. The moment I say the small x is 0, then I know that this is the inner region and this is the outer region. I hope all of you are able to see this. Now this inner region and outer, once I know that this is the outer region, I know that here the solution is y0 of x is c0 minus e power minus x. Immediately it means that to determine c0, I have to apply the boundary condition here. That is x is equal to 1. Okay, we use x equal to 1 to determine c0. That's exactly what I've done here. And from this, I get y of 0 equals this. And for the inner solution is valid here. The boundary condition that I'll use is y of 0 is equal to 1. By doing this, I get a final, I get both the solutions, inner and outer, in the two regions. Now, the only parameter that we have to determine now is we have this one more constant, which is c1. Okay, remember, The inner equation was a second order equation. This one. It's a second order equation. If it's a second order equation, it means it has two boundary conditions. One boundary condition we are clearly. This is the inner solution. The inner solution is clearly two equations and two boundary conditions are needed. One is clearly I'm applying at x equal to 0. What about the other one here? Okay. So we apply something called the Van Dyke matching principle. The Van Dyke matching principle says the limit of small x going to the outer solution of capital X is equal to the limit of inner solution x going to the inner solution, which means that, let me explain this. This is capital X going towards the outer limit is equal to small x going to the inner limit, which means that I have got a solution capital Y here. I have got a solution small y outer here. And I've got inner here. So what we are going to do is we are going to match this in a region where we're saying the inner has to reach towards the outside and the outer has to reach towards the inside. By applying these limits, I will be able to match the solutions somewhere in the middle, somewhere in this region. Okay. So that's exactly what we are going to do. If I match these solutions, this becomes the remember the in what was the variable here for the inner variable? I took small x is capital X by epsilon. Okay. That's what I took because when X is, did I make a mistake there? Let me just show again. The inner variable is small x is delta times X. Sorry. I'm sorry about this. The inner variable is small x is epsilon times capital X, which means the small x is really small. Okay. So if I have to, so the way to think about this is the inner region is so small, epsilon is arbitrary, remember. Okay. And the width of this region is epsilon, though it doesn't look like in the figure. Okay. I can make this region so small, I can make it vanishingly small by choosing a very small value of epsilon. If I choose a very small value of epsilon, this entire solution y of x, for this y of x, it's contained in that small region. So to even go towards the outer region, meaning to escape from this gray region and go to the outer region, this is outer. To escape from the inner region to outer region, you have to have a very, very large value of x. So which means that by the time you start at x equal to 0, and by the time you reach here, x has already reached very, very large, which we'll call it as infinity. Okay. So in other words, it's a highly stretched variable. You're stretching that out region. Okay. Now, similarly, the outer region when you're sitting in the outer region, the inner region is so small, it doesn't even appear to you. It'll almost appear at x equal to zero. It is so small. Okay. So from an outer region, this place will look so tiny that you really have to go towards x equal to 0. So that's exactly what we have written. The outer limit going towards outer means going to infinity, capital X going to infinity. Going to inner region means small x going to 0. And therefore, I basically have, by using this, I can get the constant C1. This is another additional condition that we have got to get the constant C1. And once we have got the constant C1, I can now write down what is called as a total composite solution, which means that it's a combination of an inner region plus an outer region. It's the sum of those two, but you shouldn't do double counting. So we basically subtract out an overlap variable. Okay. I will slightly skip this part so the idea is this. Okay. Let's look at the solutions. Okay. Now the inner solution is this. This is inner. Okay. The magenta one that you see is the outer. Okay. The green one that you see is the composite solution. The other one, don't worry about the other one. That is for different values of epsilon I've plotted. Okay. So you see that the actual solution starts at x equal to 1. Sorry, y equal to 1. It very rapidly drops. Very, very rapidly drops. Therefore, the slope dy by dx is very, very large, the magnitude, and then it will reverse itself. Okay. And then it will again slowly reach. You see the slope of this, the slope in the outer region and the slope in the inner region are very, very different. And if you basically take an even smaller value of epsilon, okay, then the slope can be made even steeper. Okay, did anybody have a question? Okay, I'll skip this part. Okay, now let's return again to the Blaisius boundary layer. Okay, the Blaisius boundary layer equations. Somebody has the camera on, Ramakant, I think. So the Blaisius boundary layer equations, the Prandtl's equations, this is the simplified version of those Blaisius boundary layer equations for a steady state. Okay. And it was eventually solved by his student Blaisius in a few years later. So in this equation, what we actually have is, what Blaisius did is he assumed what is called as a similarity profile. Okay. So he assumed that the variation in X and the variation in Y can be combined using this variable called the similarity variable, okay, which you can notice that the similarity variable has X and Y together. Okay. And using this, and you also say that this U is a function of both X and Y. Okay. So you're separating, you, if you write it in terms of similarity variable and substitute it, then you will get that you can convert this PDE, partial differential equation, into an ordinary differential equation. Of course, the only sort of thing that you have to do is you have to pay is you go from a second order equation. This is second order PDE. You end up getting a third order ODE. That's not surprising because you typically will put boundary for this PDE. You will put two boundary conditions in Y, one boundary condition in X, because it is first derivative in X, two derivatives in Y. Therefore, you will have three boundary conditions for that PDE. The third order ODE, you also get three boundary conditions. Okay. So there are very higher order boundary layer theory. I will not go into these details. It's the boundary layer theory has been developed to a massive sophistication. People have computed these solutions to an extraordinary level. For example, this is a flow near separation, when the flow basically is going over a plate or a surface and it is separating. Then people have determined that this region, your boundary layer region, can be split into multiple small regions. Okay. There is something called a triple deck theory, where individual solutions are got in multiple regions and are matched together. Okay. Another very classical, beautiful example of singular perturbation problem is this Landau-Lewitt flow. Okay. This is an absolutely phenomenal success story of perturbation methods in boundary layers. Incidentally, this solution was obtained by Landau and Lewitt even before boundary layer theory was developed, or perturbation methods were systematically developed. Okay. So what you really have in this problem is, it's a very simple problem. I have worked on this myself. So look at the problem on the left. Okay. The problem on the left is, you have a plate sitting in a fluid. Okay. And when the plate is sitting on the fluid, you have a small meniscus there. Okay. Here the fluid bends when it's close to the scale of this, by the way, is only a few millimeters. For air and water, this is about 2.7 millimeters. So you will see this whenever you put a straw in, let's say in a cup or in a glass of water, when you put a straw, or just observe very carefully if you take water in a glass or a mug, you will see that the water bends at the corners and the ends. Okay. That little bend is what we're talking about. Okay. So, but now, this is when there is no motion of the plate, this is the shape you get. You can calculate it exactly. But the moment the plate is moving up, then the fluid gets dragged upwards. And when the fluid gets dragged, you get a coating. You get a thin coating of fluid. The question is, what is the thickness of the coating? Okay. Again, this gets too technical for a talk like this. But the whole idea of Landau-Lewitt, and I've broken down into this very simple solution here. The whole idea of Landau-Lewitt is a solution that was developed by Landau-Lewitt is, they recognize that you can actually break down the problem into multiple regions. Okay, an outer region, in this case, outer region is the static region. This is outer region. And this is the inner region. Okay. So you can break down the problem into multiple regions and get solutions in each region. Okay. And again, this is a bit too technical here. Basically, you can write down the equations with the boundary conditions on the surface, and you can non-dimensionalize the equations. You can get the outer region. Outer region is also called a static region, by the way. Okay, that's what I wrote here. Static is the outer region. You can get the outer region, and in the outer region, you can solve for the solution. Okay, in this outer region. Similarly, you can solve for the inner region or the transition region. Now, epsilon here is basically given by this number called the capillary number. So capillary number is nothing but mu u by sigma. It is viscous to surface tension. Okay. And this is a problem where surface tension is a dominant force, which means that capillary number is very small. So in the earlier problems that you saw in the differential equations, we kept seeing this epsilon. Like we saw epsilon y double prime plus y prime is something, right? So the epsilon in this problem, epsilon is capillary power 1/3. Okay. So when epsilon becomes small, sorry, capillary number becomes small, epsilon is also small. Therefore, you can do an expansion in capillary power 1/3 and find the solution. Okay. So the broad summary is the following. You have to first find an outer solution, then you have to find a suitable inner solution, and you match the two solutions in an overlap region. It's all really, well, I've called it as all really simple because of a quote that Sherlock Holmes says. If you're a fan of Sherlock Holmes or Arthur Conan Doyle, this is a quotation from Sherlock Holmes. He says, when you follow two chains of thought, Watson, you will find some point of intersection which should approximate the truth. So in our context, what we're really doing is we have an outer solution which is valid only away from one boundary. We have an inner solution which is valid near one boundary. But you basically can match the two regions, create an overlap solution, and construct an approximate solution, which construct a solution which is approximates the exact solution, which is exact solution is the truth. Okay. So this is exactly what is done in boundary layer theory as well. You have a region which is valid very, very close to the plate. That is the boundary layer equations. You also have a solution which is valid far away from the plate. That is a uniform flow, and you match the two solutions. Okay. So with this, I will stop my lecture, and I hope you've got some appreciation for how people apply boundary layer theory in fluid mechanics. I'll be happy to take any questions. I think, I don't know if Ashok is there. Jayadevan, you have raised a hand.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, it's about choosing this parameter epsilon, this perturbation parameter. I think...
Go ahead.
I think Ashok sir is also there, I think so. Because how to choose this value? This Ashok sir was talking about one Duffing oscillator.
Duffing oscillator.
Yeah, in that the epsilon was a coefficient of, I think, a third order theta. Epsilon okay. Theta cube, something like that.
Okay.
So whether if you want to get that value, that epsilon value, is there any method or standard systems or models we have to solve or to find out that one, or it comes from our intuition, or it's depends upon
the... Okay. Let me tell you. I will tell you the context of the Duffing oscillator, if I remember correctly. The Duffing oscillator would be something like this: x double dot plus some, let's say, gamma x dot plus kx, correct? plus you put a non-linearity in, I think, the spring constant. Okay. So it'll be something like epsilon x cube. Is if you're talking about a forced Duffing oscillator, then you have some constant f cos omega t. Is that correct? Something like this. No, this is the Duffing equation. But this is the Duffing equation.
This one. And I'm talking about this value epsilon in that perturbation parameter or bookkeeping parameter.
No, I'm coming to that. So you see here this is the equation. What you want to do is you want to solve this equation. But then the problem is you have this nonlinear term. Correct?
Yeah.
So how do you deal with that nonlinearity is a challenge, because the nonlinearity, it's a cubic nonlinearity. So therefore it's a nonlinear term there. Okay. And yeah. So you can't use a standard, you can't just have a simple exact solution to this. Okay. So the small parameter is really being dictated by this value of the, so epsilon will come into the small parameter.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, if your question is, how do I determine, how do I know? Maybe it's not epsilon. Maybe it's something epsilon par something. Is that your question?
No. How we will get that value, exact value of epsilon? It's all telling epsilon is very, very small.
No.
Epsilon is 0.01.
No, I think you misunderstood. Jaydevan, the idea is, the idea is not to determine epsilon.
Okay.
You understand? The whole goal of this approach is not to determine epsilon. The whole goal of the approach is, if epsilon is very, very small and arbitrary, it can be any value. Can we get an approximate solution without solving the full exact solution or trying to solve this numerically? So typically, if I want to solve this equation numerically, if I have to solve the Duffing equation for any value of epsilon, I can easily solve this in MATLAB numerically.
Yeah.
That's very easy. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. But if I have to get the disk, what if I ask you a simple question, tell me how does the solution behave with epsilon? How would you answer that question? The only way to answer that question is you would do an enormous number of simulations for different values of epsilon.
Correct? Yes.
And yes, you have to analyze so many solutions.
Yeah.
Instead, I will say epsilon is small, but I don't know the value of epsilon. When I say don't know the value, I'm not even trying to determine the value. It's like I'm not trying to determine the value of gamma and k. That has to be given to me. All I'm saying is, can I get x as a function of epsilon?
Okay.
Can I get the relationship between x and epsilon? Because immediately it tells me, okay, epsilon is small. Is it okay to throw out this term epsilon x cube? That's a valid question, right? If epsilon is very, very small, maybe this term as a whole can be approximate thrown out.
Yeah.
Then you say, you throw it out and get the solution. Okay. In this particular problem, by the way, this is not a boundary layer kind of problem, because in the universal sense, because the derivatives are still satisfied. Okay. The boundary That's conditions, you still have two boundary conditions.
Yes.
Derivative is not going away. Okay.
Yeah.
But you will get the secular growth and so on. Okay.
Yeah.
In problems like this.
Even,
okay.
Even that's what my question. Even that epsilon is very small, this derivative is very significant, and we cannot ignore that that value, right? The epsilon value.
Yes, it depends on the problem. It depends on the on the nature on.
Uh-huh.
Not every problem is not just because you have a small epsilon doesn't mean it's a boundary layer problem. Okay. For example, I can take a simple spring mass damper system, x double dot plus a gamma x dot plus kx is equal to zero. Is let's say again write it as f cos omega t, correct?
Yeah.
If gamma is very, very small, it's not a singular perturbation problem.
Okay.
If gamma is small, it means the solution will not decay at large time, that's all. But it is not a singular perturbation problem.
Yes.
Okay. I will give you two initial conditions and you can perfectly solve it. Okay.
Yeah.
Not every problem is a singular perturbation problem. You can, yeah. If gamma is very, very small, then the next step is, if I were to do it, what I would do is I'll say x of I want a solution for all time, but as a function of gamma, I will, for arbitrary gamma, I will say x0 plus gamma x1 plus gamma square x2 and so on. I will do an expansion in gamma.
Yes.
Okay. So perturbation, you should understand the perturbation methods applying is not just a way of solving problems. It's also a way of thinking about problems. Okay.
So somebody to approximate that value, it depends upon the condition of that problem, right? Type of problem. Because in this problem, we have approximated epsilon as delta. And in another problem, we approximated as a capillary number. Something like
that. Yes, it depends on the problem. Of course, you will have to do so. The way you in a even any given problem, like the Landau-Lewis problem, right?
Huh? Yeah, Landau-Lewis.
In this particular Landau-Lewis problem, determining what should be the small parameter. All I know is, well, let's say when you start the problem, all you know is capillary number is small. This parameter CA is very small. That much you know.
Okay.
That doesn't immediately mean that CA is the small parameter. CA is like epsilon. No. You have to do some analysis and determine that it is not, it turns out that it is not CA, but actually CA power 1 by 3. Okay, that requires a bit more analysis and it will be a little difficult for me to explain right now for this. You need to do what is called as a dominant balance to determine what is the correct value of the small parameter that you have to choose. Okay. I was saying, perturbation methods is also not just a way of solving for problems. Okay. It is also a way of thinking about problems. See, when I first asked in the chat, somebody posted, when I first asked, how do you solve this first order equation? Some people said Runge Kutta, correct?
Oh, yes.
Why did that come to mind? Because if you talk to a numerical person, a person who does a lot of numerical solutions, when you basically give a problem, the person will immediately start thinking about how can I program this, okay, into a thing. If you go to a CFD person, the first thing is if you see when the person sees a complicated problem, an interesting fluid dynamics problem, the person will think, how can I program, how can I set up a CFD simulation to do this, correct? Okay.
Yes.
In the same way, an experimentalist will think, can I think about a nice, elegant experiment that I can do to understand this problem, correct?
Yes.
In the same way, a perturbation theory person trained in perturbation theory will say, what is a small parameter? Can I do some simplified analysis so that I can pull out the essential physics of the problem?
Okay.
Each of these are different approaches to looking at problems, okay? I'm sorry, I did not realize that my camera was turned off. Okay, each of them are different approaches, okay?
Okay. Whether it can be a function of some parameter or exact number, epsilon.
Typically epsilon is a number in a problem.
No.
Like it could be Reynolds number, it could be Capley number, it depends on the physical problem. Okay.
Okay, sir, thank you, sir.
All right, okay. Any other questions? Martin, I didn't get your question. Influence of epsilon on exact solution is less. I didn't understand that question. That's why I didn't take it up. Can you elaborate on it? Dr. Martin, are you there? Okay. So it's fine. If there are no questions, then maybe we'll end the session here. Is Ashok there here? It's being recorded. I think it can be stopped.
Sir, I'm Ashok sir, student, sir. I will
take... Sorry?
I'm Prabhat, sir, Ashok sir, student.
Yeah, you can stop the recording. It doesn't have, it's the session has ended.
Okay, sir.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'm done.
Yeah, I'm closing.
Yeah, sure. Oh, you can stop.